In this video, we're going to give necessary and sufficient conditions for a polyhedron to have extreme points. The first thing to realize is that not every polyhedron has extreme points. A very simple example is a half space in R2. This is the set of points that satisfy A transpose X greater than or equal to B, for some non-zero vector A and for some scalar B. Such a half space is a polyhedron that doesn't have any extreme points. Now, there are several ways to do that, and I encourage you to try to show this using the different definitions of a vertex, extreme point, and basic feasible solution. A simple way to see that the half space doesn't have any extreme points is to use the definition of basic feasible solution. In fact, since our polyhedron is defined by only one inequality constraint, then there clearly is no basic solution at all, because that requires the existence of two linearly independent inequality constraints. More generally, as we've already discussed in section 2.2, if we have any polyhedron in Rn defined by a system Ax greater than or equal to b, where A has fewer than n rows, then this polyhedron cannot have any basic feasible solution for the same reason, since the definition of basic solution requires the existence of n linearly independent rows, which you don't have in this case. In this video, we will see two necessary and sufficient conditions for the existence of an extreme point, and one of them depends on whether a polyhedron contains a line or not. The next thing that I want to do is to define what it means for a polyhedron to contain a line. But first, let's see the idea behind this with a couple of examples. On the left here, we have a polyhedron P which does contain a line. In fact, you can pick any line that is parallel to the two that define P and which lies among the two of them. In this way, you can obtain a line, actually many of them, which are fully contained in P. Here, we're not really interested if it contains many lines or just one. The question is if it contains at least one, and P therefore contains at least one line. On the other hand, the polyhedron Q on the right clearly doesn't contain any line. In fact, no matter how hard you try, you will never be able to find a line that is fully contained in Q. For example, if you take a vertical line, this line will exit Q both here at the bottom and here at the top. Things go a little bit better if you try with an horizontal line. In this case, on the right, the line will be always contained in your polyhedron Q. However, on the left, it will eventually exit the polyhedron Q, for example, here. Of course, there are not just vertical and horizontal lines. You should try any possible slope, but it's clear that our intuition here tells us that Q doesn't contain any line. So now that we have a little bit of a better grasp of what it means for a polyhedron to contain a line, let's give the formal definition. A polyhedron P in Rn contains a line if there exists a vector x in P and a direction vector d, which is non-zero, such that x plus lambda d is in P for all lambdas in R. So you can think of this algebraic expression x plus lambda d as any point x in the line plus the direction of the line. And since we can pick any lambda in R, this means that we can go from x in the direction d as much as we want with both positive and negative lambdas. And that's how you obtain your line. Now, to fully understand what it means for a polyhedron to contain a line, I suggest that you do the following exercise. Essentially, this exercise tells you that you can slightly change the definition of contains a line and still obtain an equivalent definition. In fact, you could remove there exists a vector x in P, and instead write for every vector x in P. So in the exercise, you're showing that if P contains one line, let's say x bar plus lambda d, then P contains all the lines x plus lambda d for every x in P. Now we are ready to give the necessary and sufficient conditions for a polyhedron to have extreme points. Let's read through this theorem. We are considering here a polyhedron of the form x in Rn such that Ai transpose x greater than or equal to bi for I from 1 to m. In this theorem, then, we are also assuming that this polyhedron is non-empty. Then the following conditions are equivalent. A, P has at least one extreme point. B, P does not contain a line, and C, there exist n vectors out of the family A1, AM, which are linearly independent. And these A1, AM are the left-hand sides of the M linear inequalities defining P. Next, let's see a sketch of the proof of this theorem. I will leave to you to write down the complete proof. In this theorem, we have to prove equivalency between three different statements. So what we're going to do is prove that A implies C, then C implies B, and finally that B implies A. So let's start with A implies C. This direction is trivial, we just need to use the definition of a basic solution. In fact, from A, we know that P has at least one extreme point, therefore it has at least one basic solution. Now we know that in every basic solution there are n linearly independent active constraints, so in particular there are n linearly independent vectors among the A1, AM. Next, we prove that C implies B, and we're going to show this implication by contradiction. So we assume, by contradiction, that the polyhedron P does contain a line. Let's say that this line is x plus lambda d, where x is a point in P and d is a non-zero vector. Since this line is fully contained in P, you can show that all the vectors Ai must be orthogonal to d. You can prove this statement by contradiction. Assume that some Ai is not orthogonal to d. Then you can show that by picking lambda large enough or small enough, the vector x plus lambda d will violate the corresponding inequality Ai transpose x greater than or equal to bi. At this point, you have shown that d is orthogonal to all the vectors Ai, but we're assuming from C that among the vectors A1, AM, there are n linearly independent ones. Now, since d is orthogonal to all of them, if you add to this family A1, AM the vector d, you obtain a total number of n plus 1 linearly independent vectors in Rn. And this, of course, is not possible, so you obtain your contradiction and you have proven that C implies B. Finally, let's see why B implies A. And this is for sure the most complicated part of the proof. So here we're assuming that P doesn't contain a line, and we want to show that the polyhedron P has at least one extreme point. Now, the proof is constructive, which means that we will be constructing such an extreme point. So how are we going to do this? Let's visualize it in a picture. Remember that in the assumption of our theorem, we know that P is non-empty. So let's pick a vector x in my polyhedron. Now we want to go from x into some direction d. Given the specific vector x, we can pick any direction. However, the argument that I give is iterative, and later on in the next iterations I will pick a more specific direction. So anyway, at this point, let's pick just any direction d, like in this picture. Now remember that we know that P doesn't contain a line, and this means that if we go in the direction d or in the opposite direction, in at least one of these two directions, we will eventually leave the polyhedron. In this case, you see in both directions. If we go down, we will eventually leave the polyhedron, and even if we go up. So let's pick one direction, which will lead to us leaving the polyhedron P. So in this picture, we go down. The idea is that we continue going in this direction, and we stop just before leaving the polyhedron. We will obtain this point, which in the picture is x plus lambda star d. Now in this point x plus lambda star d, there is one active constraint, namely the inequality defining this segment over here. And now we repeat the argument. So what do? We start from our current point, x plus lambda star d, and now we choose to go in a new direction, but this direction must have the property that all the active constraints at this point remain active. So in this case, we're only allowed to go along the active inequality, so either in this direction or in the opposite. Once again, since the polyhedron doesn't contain a line, in at least one of these two directions, you will eventually leave the polyhedron. So let's follow one such direction. In this case, we go to the right, and we stop just before leaving the polyhedron. Now you're forced to stop because you have found a new active constraint. What you can show now is that the vector AI defining this new active constraint will be linearly independent from all the other vectors AJ of the constraints that were already active at your point. This of course requires a proof that I leave as an exercise to you. Once you have shown this though, the proof is essentially complete because you have a way of iteratively finding a point that satisfies one more linearly independent active constraint. So you can repeat this argument until the vector that you find will satisfy n linearly independent active constraints. Once it does, your point is feasible, of course, because you always remained inside P, and it's also a basic solution because there are n linearly independent active constraints. Therefore, P has a basic feasible solution. And this is exactly what we had to show in A, because we know that basic feasible solutions are extreme points. So this concludes the sketch of the proof of theorem 2.6. Again, it's a great exercise for you to figure out all the details of this proof and write down a complete proof. Next, let's see a few examples of polyhedra that do not contain a line and therefore that have extreme points. For each such example, I suggest that you write a complete proof of why they do not contain a line. So the first one is polytopes. So why polytopes don't contain a line? Well, every polytope is contained in a box, and it's simple to show that boxes cannot contain lines. The second example is the positive orthant, which is the set of points x in Rn that satisfy x greater than or equal to 0. How can you show that the positive orthant doesn't contain any line? I suggest you prove this by contradiction. If it did contain a line, look at the direction vector d. You know that this vector is non-zero, so it has at least one non-zero component. Let's say that this is the first component of the vector, d1. Then, if you choose lambda correctly, you can obtain points in the line which have x1. Then you can obtain points in your line that have x1 negative, which directly implies that the line is not contained in the positive orthant. Finally, the third example is polyhedra in standard form. Why they don't contain any line? This is simple, because polyhedra in standard form are contained in the positive orthant. So if the positive orthant doesn't contain any line, then neither can polyhedra in standard form. Now, using our examples of polyhedra that don't contain a line, together with theorem 2.6, we obtain the following corollary, which says that non-empty polytopes and non-empty polyhedra in standard form have at least one basic feasible solution. So now we've understood exactly when polyhedra contain basic feasible solutions. In the next video, we will understand when these basic feasible solutions are optimal solutions to our linear programming problem.